Red Dwarf is the sitcom that boldly goes where no sitcom has gone before.
He's a smig.
I've been called Smeggin every day of my life since 1988.
Step up to red alert.
Sir, are you absolutely sure? It does mean changing the bulb.
Couldn't think of anything better. Great scripts, the opportunity to perform them, that's what Red Dwarf's all about.
Its spaced-out adventures have been making us laugh for over 30 years, and the voyage continues.
I didn't think that 30-odd years later I'd still be sticking on the dreadlocks and the leather jacket.
Oh, look, I'm going to pop it up!
It's very age-inappropriate now, let me tell you.
In this series, we get the inside story on the world's most celebrated sci-fi comedy from the people who made it.
I'm almost annoyed.
I'm 100% unaware of the mask. I haven't got a clue that I've got a mask on. I'm just crying.
I humbly name this moon Rimmer.
The character of Rimmer, I don't think I'd base it on anyone in particular. I couldn't find anyone on the planet who was quite that sad.
We both said that at the same time. And that.
You'll never get bored of being in Red Dwarf because you don't know where they're going to take you next.
Here it comes!
Over the next hour, we find out just how hard it is to make a space-based sitcom.
Everything that you could think of in science fiction is in Red Dwarf.
From remembering mind-boggling lines...
Well, you had all the exposition, didn't
exposition
you?
And all the scientific stuff.
Not if we insert an NTK chip into him to keep him going until he becomes this Mr. Lister and we can reinsert the kidneys that we stole from the other Mr. Lister shitting.
Dressing the only highly evolved feline in the universe.
How'd you keep up with a guy like that?
And trying to make the whole thing look like a Hollywood movie on a BBC budget.
I felt like, wow, this is the bee's knees.
So sit back, slob out, and enjoy the first 3 million years of Red Dwarf.
Still on board, looking for a way home in a really hot curry.
I am Tarka Doll.
Who'd have thought it?
By 1989, Red Dwarf had gained a cult following as one of the freshest and funniest sitcoms on TV.
Aliens.
Oh, God, aliens.
Your explanation for anything slightly peculiar is aliens, isn't it? You lose your keys, it's aliens. A picture falls off the wall, it's aliens. That time we used up a whole bog roll in a day. You thought that was aliens as well?
Well, we didn't use it all, Lister. Who did?
Remember, aliens used our bog roll.
Its first two sci-fi series had been a success, despite the wobbly grey sets and low-tech effects. But to secure its future, it needed rebooting. And creators Rob Grant and Doug Naylor were determined to do just that.
It wasn't until series three came along where I felt, boof, we'd gone up another notch.
From the very beginning, series three landed with a bang. A brand new opening sequence, reworked theme music, and the old sets were strapped to a rocket and fired into a black hole.
We started to do things in series three, which was really kind of testing what it was possible to do within the sitcom. But I think what we wound up with was something that was elevated from season two.
It was boom, and it was all of a sudden it was a different animal.
A major addition to series three was a helpful cyber sidekick.
Name?
I'll just put Crichton.
I was really impressed with the kind of quality of the sets and the detail. Craig, Chris and Dan were constantly going on about how much better the set was. They were really blown away by it when we saw it. But for me, it was always like that. I'd never known any different.
Rob and I were promoted to producers in time for series three. The first thing we did was we brought in Mel Bibby, who was the head production designer at BBC Manchester. And Mel, so totally in tune with the series, in tune with what we wanted.
The new look, an additional cast member, was the final piece of the interstellar jigsaw.
It was now a bona fide hit.
Series 3 was slicker and bigger and it became less of a domestic sitcom.
Stop your blithering, Crichton. Come on, grab the cat and let's go.
No, screw you, Hadron Head.
Red Dwarf stopped being a cult science fiction show really by the end of Series 3. It was just a popular comedy show. How big can your cult be? You know, it's got to be... It was a major religion.
Red Dwarf was now well on its way to becoming an intergalactic classic. But as well as the ship's interior, the cast's clobber also got a makeover, thanks to costume designer Howard Burden.
Something's different. Wait a minute, I never used to be a man.
Oh, Howard, fantastic. You kind of suggest something, normally it's in the script. He'd come up with the designs, and Howard was brilliant at that. But at the same time, completely off the wall, clever as well.
You're very much hands-on. I mean, that's always been the case with Dwarf Studios. We're in the costume room sort of making stuff or sticking stuff. It's not some big megabucks budget. And, you know, it's almost like a sort of theatre.
Howard was beamed aboard at the start of Series 3, and the first targets for a visit to his fitting room were the ship's crew.
I took the script, and because I hadn't seen any of the previous episodes, and then just reinvented these characters. Rimmer, there was a line in the script about Captain Emerald, and it just stuck in my head, and I just wanted this hologrammatic, sort of shiny textural fabric and stuff. Craig was the space bum, so I took all his sort of slightly rock and roll, art school, that sort of thing, so graffiti's jacket. Crichton was the mechanoid, so I had this idea, you know, I thought, well, that's, you know, we'll get the sort of metallic look and so on and so forth.
You okay, man?
I'm fine, thank you, Susan.
That's Howard walking past there, naturally.
He made me bloody suit, that bastard. There he is, look. Unnaturally.
We've had huge changes with Crichton around the groinal area. I could either stand up or sit down.
Breakfast is served, sir.
I couldn't swap between the two on camera because it required people holding my bottom on.
But what it lacked in flexibility, Crichton's mechanoid crutch made up for in practicality.
I just thought I'd give your quarters a quick tickle around, sir. I won't take a jiff.
Not now, Crichton, I'm cooking.
It was just schoolboy humour, but it was just funny, and it just was one of the biggest laughs, I think, from a costume point of view, that I've ever had. The cat, I was able to be extravagant and sort of give him a lot of fantastic costumes.
You heard him.
Yeah, I thought I was looking quite shabby today, actually, compared to the cat. Yeah, but how'd you keep up with a guy like that?
Let's face it, buddy, I have a body that makes men wet. It's real bad. See what I mean? Red with apricot. I look like a jerk. I'm bleeding an unfashionable colour. Somebody please get me a tailor.
It was always exciting to see, oh, what's he going to turn up in next? And that sort of became a joke in itself, I think, when the cat was going to appear in the episode and what he was going to have on now.
There's one thing you should know. Last time we met, I was wearing a cute little black number with peach trim and gold spangles. And although it looks like I'm wearing the same outfit today, it is, in fact, an entirely different cute little black number with completely different gold spangles.
That was an important speech, sir, and it needed to be made. But might I suggest that from this moment on, the rest of this discourse is conducted by those with brains larger than a grape.
What I tried to do with him was to, you know, is to do something new and exciting for every episode. It's the vanity, really. Danny would be something that, you know, you can really excel and be creative with.
Coming up, the universe's most fashionable feline catches up with the king of his costumes.
We've never done anything you went, I hate that, I'm not wearing it.
I've gone in a couple of times and gone, ooh.
And how to make your very own mechanoid.
Cut two holes in a hot water bottle, pull it over your head, leave it on for 10 to 12 hours.
He Here at the world-famous Pinewood Studios, rehearsals are taking place for a feature-length episode of Red Dwarf. And during a break, the cat caught up with the man behind his never-ending outfits.
So apparently some of my old costumes are in here with Howard. Howie, they told me you had some of the glories up here. You? Look at that.
Trip down memory lane.
I love those drawings.
Look at that.
Yeah, I know.
Always keeping the show at the centre of the cosy.
Exactly.
That's
exactly
the secret.
You know, looking back, I mean, there's some flashbacks of old stuff here.
This episode, Rick.
Yeah, and it was a snow scene, and everyone had to be in the snow.
Yeah.
So Kat had to have a fur coat. You know, even when we did the diving suit, what are we going to do for a diving suit for him? Perfect. What's been your favourite? Have you got one?
Oh, God.
Too many. The cat evolved. I mean, that's the nice thing. He's gone on such a good journey. Yeah. When you look at the stuff that we did first up.
Yeah, it was all very, you know...
Was very right
Little
on...
Richard rock and roll.
Absolutely. And... You remember that one? The one with the original stripe?
That's right.
And you know we had no money at the very beginning.
Yeah.
And you know we had to colour it.
Yeah.
We got felt pens.
That's right.
And we coloured that to give it a new outfit. And in a funny way, we've almost come full circle. Because the one we've got for this special,
yes,
you know, it's basically the
and
similar
double-breasted and all of that.
Exactly,
yeah, you know.
Has the similar sort of vibe. That's
and we're going back
it.
To the original colour. I mean, I like this suit as well.
Well, we went quite extravagant.
That was very Teddy Boy.
And then that
Teddy
became
Boy.
Quite tailored. Yes, it was.
This is more. You know, Teddy Boy.
Yeah.
And again, that's very similar.
Which is that one?
Yeah.
You're the only one that's never changed size at all in 31 years. You got that painting up in the attic, I know you have.
Look.
I mean, that's a thick
shirt.
You
see,
too.
Look, I mean.
Hey.
And immediately, you see, as you have the jacket on.
Makes you stand.
You immediately, your posture becomes more.
Absolutely.
On your legs.
You can't slouch.
See, so you're now you're.
Yes.
Yeah, and then you imagine that, and then the right shirt, you know, you might have a ruffle or a straight tie.
We've never done anything you went, I hate that, I'm not wearing it.
No.
We've never had that.
No. I've gone in a couple of times and gone, ooh.
First time you walk on set in a new costume, I'll quietly follow, and if the crew, if you get the response,
if you get
crew,
the look,
then we're home run. There we go.
My whole cat life has just been flashed in front of me.
Thank God for the cat.
Hey.
Made my career.
That's it. You know, well, hey, it made mine too. Do you see?
Excellent.
Hands across the ocean of showbiz.
Unlike the cat, Robert Llewellyn's Crichton took significantly more time in makeup. In the latest series on Dave, advances in prosthetics have made the procedure much more comfortable. But 30 years ago, it was a very different story.
They'd made a complete mask that covers your whole head, that is all, you know, really close to the eyes and goes into your mouth. I was in the makeup chair for 5 or 6 hours, and eventually everyone went out, and I was sitting in there, and I looked in the mirror, and it was like a horror film. I mean, my heart rate went off the scale. It was like, because there's something looking at me in the mirror, and it's not me. And you go like that and it moves with me. It looks like it's fake. It was horrifying. That was the first time I'd seen myself, you know, with this other head.
I think I'm okay now.
So did you know the sort of procedure to have the mask put on and everything?
No, I had no idea.
In danger was about 7 hours, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was five hours, the average makeup.
I remember me and him coming back from the Hacienda once, because it was in the days of Manchester, you know. It was like Happy Mondays and all that kind of stuff. It was all the techno boom and all of that. And I remember us coming back from the Hacienda. It was about 5 a.m. The doors of the lift opened and there were you going to work. We were going to get our head down for 5 hours.
I remember that very clearly.
Yeah, you were going out, we were coming in.
Yeah.
Compared to Crichton's mammoth makeup sessions, the other crew members got off pretty lightly.
They were in there for 10 minutes. You know, Danny'd have his hair done in the teeth and the makeup. Craig, he already had the hair sewn in, so that was already there. Chris would walk in and go, "Morning, Bobby, on with the H, on with the show." You know, like he was there for 30 seconds.
So this is for anyone who starts saying, well, You know, Robert has a hard time with the Crichton makeup, you know, but I have a hard time as well getting that H straight, you know? We agonise, absolutely agonise over getting that straight.
What a schmied. What a schmied. What a schmied.
But just applying Crichton's makeup was the easy bit.
The nearest you could experience it would be you cut two holes in a hot water bottle, cut the neck off so you can pull it over your head, but don't just put it on for a few minutes and go, oh, it feels really weird. Leave it on for 10 to 12 hours.
I've got one. My neck's coming up. Sorry. My feet are lovely. They're all been sprayed down and cool.
How's it feeling there?
Lovely. Lovely. Once we went filming and it was raining, I mean, it just simply rained all day. I said, you know, guys, I think we've gone as far as we can with this. It's just so wet. And Robert said, no, really, I'm full of water. I can't. And he pressed his face and water came out of his eyes.
You know your trouble, Crichton.
What, sir?
You're a git.
Like his on-screen persona, Robert's painful prosthetics didn't garner much sympathy from his fellow cast members. But in Siliconia, in Series 12, they got the chance to see just how easy it was to wear a hot water bottle on your head all day.
For once, I walked on the set without makeup on, and there's the three of them in makeup, and they were, Danny was ironing and Chris was mopping the floor or something. They were really into it.
I'm rather enjoying mopping this floor. I feel so calm and tranquil.
I'm rather enjoying making these sandwiches too, I must confess.
I think I'm getting the hang of this. I am!
People sort of looking at you and sort of saying, oh, you're sort of Crichtonized, but you kind of still look like you.
When the boys all became Crichton, I think for Robert it was kind of payback time.
Yeah, oh. Great. Thank you, Chris.
Yeah,
sorry.
Look at that. Is it coming out?
Oh, God.
There's a lot of people that said, oh, it must have been great to get your own back on them. Well, I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy. I was impressed with how they put up with it because I know what it's like.
We were really unsympathetic. Oh, stop moaning, you old git. But having done it, you've got to take my hat off to him. But then again, he's had three books out of this, hasn't he? The man in the rubber mask, you know what I mean? He's a bit of fortune out of it. Get on with it.
Alternative versions of the characters would be a recurring theme aboard Red Dwarf over the years, each one an opportunity to raid Howard's dressing-up box.
Where's it now?
It's gone back down to the cargo bays, sleeping off a four-course meal of fear, vanity, guilt and anger.
I love the bit in Polymorph where they all lose their one emotion that drives them. I think that's hilarious.
It was just a joy and I suppose a sort of release in many ways to have Rimmer's anger removed.
Look, just because it's an armour-plated alien killing machine that salivates unspeakable slobber doesn't mean it's a bad person. What we've got to do is get it round a table, put together a solution package, perhaps over tea and biscuits.
Look at him. You can't trust his opinion. He's got no anger. He's a total dork.
Good point, Crichton. Let's take that on board, shall we?
It's a comedy. You can virtually do anything you like, so why not try and stretch the boundaries as much as you possibly can?
Cat, let's have your contribution. Come on.
Don't ask me my opinion. I'm nobody. Just I'm not here.
That's lovely. Thank you very much.
The whole sort of alter egos playing different characters, that's great fun, actually. It mixes it up a little bit as well.
One of my favourite episodes was Demons and Angels, where they play horrible versions and angelic versions of themselves.
Brother Rimmer is portraying agony.
The soul that searches out the truth. The truth danced by Brother Cat.
Demons and Angels was another great episode, actually. Demon Rimmer was extraordinary.
Hello, my professor.
It was such an uncomfortable outfit. I'm sure there were pins sticking into me and all sorts of things. It motivated me to be, you know, low Rimmer. Because of, you know, the outfit sort of inspired that kind of evil, you know?
I'm going to lash you to within an inch of your life.
Once you get to know someone that well, you can tell when they're delivering it with some relish. All his stuff about whipping people and everything, he was really enjoying himself.
Perhaps the most shocking alter egos ever appeared in Back to Reality, a mind-meltingly surreal installment seeing viewers faced with the unthinkable. Our heroes might have been imposters the whole time. And for the cat, that meant the ultimate identity crisis.
When our characters were revealed to the audience,
The audience were howling. And I was saying, I don't want to look down the line. Chris Barry's here, and Craig's wig. We were all struggling to keep a straight face, and the audience were just waiting for gold, and they got it.
What the hell's happened to my teeth? I can open beer bottles with my overbite.
As soon as you see Dwayne Dibley, you go, yes, I know exactly what this is. This is the cat's alter ego.
Everyone who was on the show was just in hysterics from start to finish, really, because here he's going from this cool customer, the cat, you know, and these fantastic outfits, and, you know, the cool elan of the cat, going to this absolute doink.
So this is really me? A no-style gimbo with teeth the Druids could use as a place of worship?
Dwayne Dibley was hilarious for Danny. It was all about the really bad Parker, the terrible knitwear, the sort of, you know, the polyester check trousers, socks and sandals.
Dwayne Dibley!
Everything that was bad, that was good with him.
Coming up, Big Bangs.
Craig, I don't think you've got anything to worry about.
And why you should never work with robots.
They just go berserk.
Or Craig Charles.
A working prop was something Craig Charles hasn't touched.
Red Dwarf made the leap from hyperspace onto our screens over 30 years ago. One thing set it apart from any other sitcom of the time. Its special effects. Amazingly, these intergalactic shots weren't actually filmed in space, but in another vacuum between celestial bodies, an old shoe factory off the A40, otherwise known as the BBC Visual Effects Department.
I think there's a fallacy that people think that special effects only is science fiction shows. We'd been doing sitcoms like Last of the Summer Wine. Every time Compo goes down a hill in a bathtub, it's normally an effects department prop. So when Red Dwarf turned up, and it was a six-episode sitcom, it was a little bit, oh, well, do you want funny effects then? And Peter Ragg went, no. He said, it's only going to work if the effects are done straight. It's the script that's funny.
We've lost it. Sorry, I was looking at the wrong panel.
The mastermind behind the illusion of space travel was the late Peter Ragg.
Peter Ragg was a genius. And without him, Red Dwarf really wouldn't have been half of as good as it is.
He gave him budget 15 pence and a packet of fags, you know, and the stuff that he'd create.
Peter Ragg and the BBC special effects team. We were so lucky. Doctor Who, sadly, was coming to the end of its first iteration, and there was this amazing BBC vis effects team who were basically out of work. And we were able to take them, and then they did all their great work for us.
I always just remember the situation where Craig's going, so Pete, you know, how big are these explosions going to be? And I go, oh, Craig, I don't think you've got anything to worry about. It's just going to be, yeah. I mean, you might get a little bit of something, but it's not going to be too bad.
Shouldn't this plug into something?
Oh, yeah, that joins up with the white cable.
A white cable?
Yeah.
I had to propel myself on one of those small trampolines, and then I'm exploded over this console.
Or is it the yellow cable?
Crazy. I thought you said there were going to be little explosions.
And when it came to hyper-realistic models, Peter Ragg's knowledge was unsurpassed.
Peter had been responsible for flying Thunderbird 2 in Thunderbirds. He'd worked on Captain Scarlet. And he passed on all that knowledge that he'd accumulated to us.
He came in one day, there was a photograph of him laying down Virgil Tracy on the set of Thunderbirds. And you know that thing, God, he did work on Thunderbirds. And that moment where he really did work on Thunderbirds, and that was it. He was then walking on air.
Peter Ragg and that team of who do the special effects back then particularly were just extraordinary. The legacy of their work, which was things like Thunderbirds, really came to the fore. If you look at those models close up, they're extraordinary.
The Red Dwarf model used in the title sequences, Peter did a very crude sketch, a literal back of a fag packet sketch. And that was given to model makers who pretty much built what Peter drew, which was a big red brick.
The big red brick made its debut at the very start of the very first programme.
The opening titles, massive ship, floating past camera like that with the beautiful music. It was like, wow, this is the bee's knees.
The hulking Red Dwarf model may have given its name to the series, but a smaller, greener craft also became a fan favourite.
Can you see that space vehicle?
Where?
That one?
Yes, sir.
And can you read the registration for me, please?
Starbug 1?
This is the original design for what became Starbug. At this stage, it was known as the White Midget. This was a design which, at the time, I thought was going to be a lesser design, and I built it up using elements from the previous design into this, and that was submitted, and that was what Rob and Doug chose. And, of course, it went on to become Starbug.
Starbug appeared regularly from Series 3 onwards, and as an exploration craft, it was often, quite literally, thrown into the action.
Because of the nature of the stories, the Starbug inevitably crashes or is hit by something. I've actually built dozens of these over the years. This one was actually one of the destroyed ones that's been sort of meticulously pieced back together.
The models were second to none. The same couldn't be said when it came to creating a reliable sci-fi robot to use on the studio floor.
During the first series, I was approached by Pete Ragg to produce two robots which would look a little like shoeboxes and would have an arm coming out at the tops.
What's this, guys? Don't go into stasis, please don't leave us with Rimmer. I'm sorry, guys, I've got to, we need you. I mean, there's nothing for me here, I want to go back to air.
Scutters were never reliable. The scutters always always broke down. Or just started doing random acts. They'd, like, nibble at you, or they'd get on the frequency of a local cab firm or something else, and they'd just go berserk.
It reminded me a little bit of a Triang train set, you know, where you've got it sort of on the line there. And you've got your controller and you're trying to get your coronation class steam locomotive to move, and suddenly you turn up the thing and it doesn't move one inch, and all you hear is
El Scutto here has to go back on duty in 4 minutes 31 seconds, and if he goes before the game is concluded, I win by default.
And all I'm thinking about is Peter Ragg behind the set sort of going, shit, what? It's moving, it's still moving. And all this sort of behind-the-scenes stuff going on.
They were really difficult to control. A famous scene is where Craig is being injected in his eye.
Very slowly forward.
And he had to sit still while this twitching robot came towards him with a syringe in it.
You'd know the Scutter's move was coming up, so why don't you go over there and just annoy Lister, you know, type line, and the Scutter just would sit there and start going, making noises.
The Scutter's heads were made in two different ways. One was on the actual machine, and the other one was a hand puppet.
They were tricky to work with in those early days, but when they did work, they were great. Particularly when they gave, you know, Rimmer the V's that day.
Rimmer.
The latest visual effects used in the most recent series on Dave mean nothing is impossible. A far cry from Series 1, when just pretending to be a hologram was easier said than done.
You can't touch anything. That's quite tough, because occasionally you walk into a room and you just sort of, you know, casually touch a table or something. People say, you can't do that. Hologram, you know.
I mean being a hologram?
Do you mind?
Oh,
Some of the hologram effects that we did were tough. Just to sort of have me put my hands through a table, you know, involved me doing, you know, that, and then, you know, keeping everything really still and putting the table in and mixing the, you know, it was very, very complicated to do quite simple things. And then, of course, eventually it became hard light, and that was much easier for all concerned.
Throughout the 30 years of Dwarf and the ever-changing special effects technology, there has, thankfully, been one constant.
Craig, Charles and props are never the twain shall meet.
Craig is the prop buster. That's what he was known as. Here you go,
what you it didn't matter if it was a really simple thing that wouldn't, you know, there's no way he can break this. He would still manage to break it somehow.
He can look at it and it will fall apart.
Drop your gun, sir.
Oh, so. My pistol went off in my pants. That prop lasted long, didn't it?
We haven't heard that for a few years.
Peter Ragg had spent hours crafting this really delicate prop, and I go, oh, brilliant. It all come apart in my hand. So I wasn't allowed to touch things until the take and stuff like that. Craig, don't touch it.
A working prop was something Craig Charles hasn't touched. It's as simple as that. Because Craig can literally, like, hey, that, you know, and he does it with love. It's not, he's not trying to break it.
That's amazing, man. That looks great.
And the whole front will just drop off. As soon as he touches it, he's cursed.
I think we can improve on that.
Yeah.
Coming up, in space, no one can hear you scream, except the studio audience.
Live studio is brilliant because they're there because they're fans.
And Craig Charles goes to the dogs.
Yeah, I ate the dog food. Yeah, it was real dog food, that. Yeah, yeah, it was really, yeah, yeah.
Although set millions of miles away in space, there is one element of Red Dwarf that has kept it very much in touch with us Earthlings, the studio audience.
Such a magical moment when the audience came in. It's almost like being a kid and you're doing your special play and then all the people come round to watch it.
Live studio is brilliant. They're there because they're fans and they want to hear the fluffs, they want to hear when they dry up and the lines don't go, you know, whoa, they all think that's the best thing.
Despite a brief respite in series 7 and 9, the live studio audience has been with the crew members every step of the way, even when two of them were trapped inside a stranded Starbug.
Marooned was brilliant, but because it was so concentrated on me and Chris and the amount of lines we had in that and the pressure to get it right first time, as I say, the audience, once they've seen it once, they're not going to laugh as hard the next time. So it was like doing a live stage play where you really, really couldn't screw up.
The first time was with this girl I met at cadet school called Sandra. We did it in the back of my brother's car.
What was it like?
Brilliant. Incredible. Bentley V8 convertible. Walnut burr panelling. Marvellous machine, marvellous.
Chris's performance is absolutely brilliant in it, and some of the lines in it, some of the stories that we tell, it's just genius.
So, come on, how do you lose yours?
Michelle Fisher, the ninth hole of Bootle Municipal Golf Course. Par 4, dogleg to the right, in the bunker behind the green.
You lost your virginity on a golf course? How'd you have the nerve?
It wasn't in the middle of the ride of the cup or anything.
I really liked that episode. It was a bit of a challenge because I thought, how do you keep this interesting, you know, visually? So we decided that all the cameras would be handheld. So it gives you a sense of claustrophobia. And of course, if you are handheld, you can move in with the camera very, very close. And it got to a point, I think that Lister had to eat dog food.
And you can take that look off your face like I'm doing something disgusting. I'm just trying to stay alive.
The shot was great, you know, because it gave you that kind of horror of following the stuff into his mouth.
Well, now I can see why dogs lick their testicles.
Yeah, I ate the dog food. Yeah, it was real dog food, that. Yeah, yeah, it was real, yeah. It was horrible. I used to all that bullshit. The truth was it was tuna with a little bit of jelly on it or something like that. But for years I pretended to anyone who asked that was real dog food. And people believe me, as if I'm that nuts.
The cast are all performers by nature. They love an audience. And also, the audience is one of those great argument settlers. And I used to have, you know, in the nicest way, with Craig, where Craig's going, "Are you sure that's going to get a laugh?" And I went, "Trust me," you know. Or Rob would go, "Trust me." And then the argument would be settled by the audience.
"What are we going to do?"
"Well, I say let's get out there and twat it."
It's a nerve-wracking experience trying to make people laugh, but you do settle down once that first big woofer comes in. The first big laugh, we call them woofers. When they get the first woofer, you go, "Ooh, you know, good to go."
"I don't believe anybody would want to go on a fishing holiday where they know there's no fish."
"Well, we used to do it all the time back home. Used to go down the canal. Never any fish in that. Used to go condom fishing. I swear, one time I caught this 2-pound black ribbed knobbler. It was about that big."
Being a stand-up, you want to hear that noise of saying, "Yeah, that's funny, go on, keep going, do some more."
"What's the plan?"
"I take one of Red Dwarf's thermonuclear mining torpedoes and I blow up the moon. And you'll be thrown clear in the blast."
"Is that safe?"
"I'm miles away, I'll be fine."
There were certain episodes where we struggled to sort of get the show within time because of the laughs, you know? And then Crichton trying to take Lister's pants off.
"It's a little pain in the butt."
When Craig's shorts start shrinking, and we'd rehearse this a lot, and I could see, technically, this is amusing slapstick, but not something we'd laughed at during the rehearsal.
"Help me on the pants! It's shrinking!
So when we actually started me trying to rip his shorts off, I just heard this hysterical wave of laughter from the audience.
The audience laughing so loud. I'm shouting my lines and Robert's shouting his lines back to me and I can't hear him. I'm just having to wait for his lips to stop moving for me to do my line.
Had to wait an eternity to walk in and say, "Lister, you'd bonk anything."
"Well, I can't say I'm totally shocked." "You'll bonk anything, won't you, Lister?"
Yeah, that was extraordinary. So I loved that. I loved performing in front of the audience.
While Lister's shrinking shreddies had them rolling in the aisles, during the show's early years, it was the job of one man to get them ready for such spectacles.
My involvement with Red Dwarf came about when I was comparing it to a comedy club called Jonglers in London. And after the show, I was approached by a tall, thin man who turned out to be Ed Byrne. And he said, "Have you ever done a warm-up for a TV show?" And I said, "No, I'll give it a go." The first one I did was the hardest thing I'd ever done. Because I went out and did 15 minutes, got the audience in a good mood, off they go recording, and the scutters then broke down. And they said, "Tony, can you come up?" OK, so I thought I'd be up for 2 minutes. 25 minutes later...
OK, here we go. This is my sexiest fake, Steve.
They said, "You saved the day." So we bonded from that moment on, and then instead of being like the warm-up man who's, "Oh, that person comes out and does that," they were kind of going, "Well, you're part, you know, you're part of the team, you know, you're in," and they started giving me parts.
"Your caviar, Vindaloozer."
Tony Hawks, yeah, he is almost sixth dwarfer, isn't he?
Tony's been great, and I have, in the past, done my fairly loose impersonation of Tony, and...
One of the hardest scenes I ever had to keep a straight face in was when he played Caligula.
"On your feet, pigs!"
"Hey, buddy, we just, you know..."
"Silence, scum!"
That slapping in the face stuff, it was painful trying to not laugh.
"You think I'm insane?" "Should we take a quick vote?" "Silence, scum!" "Shut up!"
Whether we saved it up a bit for the performance, because obviously when you're rehearsing, you don't want to be constantly hitting somebody, so I think we probably pretended. But in the recording, you know, he gave him a fair whack.
Luckily for the Red Dwarf crew, a firm slap from the hand of Caligula isn't dished out every time they fluff a line.
"Bollocks.
Bollocks. Oh, poo kindness. Shit, f*** it.
We both said that at the same time. And that. What's going on? Why are we saying everything together, nearly?
You know, we all fluff lines, of course, but sometimes when you fluff a line, it's good. I remember the audience came in, first scene of the night, and there was no one laughing, even funny laugh lines.
No.
They were sitting there, frozen. They weren't relaxed right. enough.
And they were like, we're in the audience at Red Dwarf. Yeah. Like,
I remember. So we had to build in a fluff.
Right. And that was it. It was just the floodgates were open. Everybody was relaxed in the studio.
Yeah, right. Your impressions, in when you fluff, you go into the Kenneth Williams impression.
That really does date the show, doesn't it?
Yes, I'm afraid so.
I then order you to don my old spacesuit, the one with the... matron. Yes, I screwed the line.
Every week. Every bloody week.
And the David Coleman.
Yeah.
The point where you guys did it.
We all did it, yeah.
Extraordinary!
Back in the day,
yeah.
To be fair, I was quite good on the lines.
Quite good, Craig. You were freakishly brilliant.
You used to annoy us to high heaven because, of course, you know, you had virtually a photographic memory.
I'd know my lines, but I'd know yours as well.
Oh, God, yeah.
Crichton always has the explanation, doesn't it?
Certainly.
Well, you had all the exposition, didn't
Exposition and all the scientific stuff.
Not if we insert an MTK chip into him to keep him going until he becomes this Mr. Lister and we can reinsert the kidneys that we stole from the other Mr. Lister shitting.
I got up with a lot of nurses, didn't I?
I don't believe those uniforms are
Get the lines right, Rob. There's a bag of chips in it for you.
Get it right, Bob. There's a bag of chips in it for you.
It's because you would always get it wrong, Bob.
Yeah, it was. Okay.
When we finally finish this scene, I'm going to take that torch and insert it somewhere. And I want you to know, it's not for my own pleasure, it's to punish the torch. Engage the triplicator.
Next time, the science behind the sitcom.
I've learnt more science being on Red Dwarf in 31 years than I ever learnt at school.
A galaxy of guest stars.
Idiots!
Working with Johnny Vegas when he was the Crypt Cop was fascinating.
And we saddle up with the Red Dwarf posse.
And I slapped it on this arse.
You slapped it and you went, yee-haw!
Yee-haw!